Hey, brothers and sisters! This is Brother Patrick! Feel like traveling on! Yeah, I'm playing those old hymnals. An anointed bunch of hymnals. Those of you who've been watching my videos, I put the link. Most of the time when people sing those old hymnals, the people singing are unanointed. So it's all those songs that's been written, almost every Christian song was inspired by God. So it's not the song, it's the singer. It's the anointing of the living God inside the one who is singing. Praise God. Like myself, I'm not a good singer. But the Lord anointed me with the Spirit and with power. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. The Lord said, "You shall receive power when the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. And you shall be a witness for me in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and to the othermost parts of the world." Praise God. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, you know I got to make more videos teaching on that. I've done it way back, and people would have to search. I don't think you can go on somebody's channel and search. I'm not sure. But I've done several videos, and I know I got to do more. Probably the number one thing people ask me is about the Holy Spirit. They want to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. And brothers and sisters, I'm going to read some words for you, and then I'm going to make videos. I got to get this done. To be baptized in the Holy Spirit, in the Bible, the evidence of which is speaking in tongues. Now, there are people who are not filled with the Holy Spirit, and they'll try to say, "Well, I've been filled with the Holy Spirit, and I baptized the Holy Spirit, but I didn't speak in tongues." Well, the evidence of baptism of the Holy Spirit in the Bible is evidenced by speaking in tongues, brothers and sisters. So, it's not the gift of tongues. I guess I'm doing a little teaching here. There's the gift of speaking in tongues for edifying in the church that needs a translator, an interpreter in the church. There's a gift of tongues, a gift of healing, the gifts of healing. There's discernment of spirits, words of wisdom, words of knowledge, all that stuff. Those nine gifts, the categories of gifts that are listed there in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. That's different than initially being baptized in the Holy Spirit. So when we're saved, we're sealed with the Holy Spirit. And then later on, we have this second experience to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Now, all through the book of Acts, we see that the people are baptized in the Holy Spirit with a manifestation, a visible manifestation of speaking in tongues and prophesying as the Holy Spirit came on people several times. I've made videos about this in the past. I need to do more. But the point is, there's many of you out there who know what I'm saying, you know, it's the biblical correct theology, and then you want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. So there's those people who want to be convinced that they can have more of God, and then there's a group that know they can have more of God, and then they want it, and they earnestly desire that. So that's two different things. The teaching that, oh, the baptism of the Holy Spirit for speaking in tongues did not cease with the Bible being written, and that it's for us today that we can be filled with the Holy Ghost and we can operate in the gifts of the Spirit. And one of those is speaking in tongues. As I said, the gift of speaking in tongues in the church is separate from baptism of the Holy Spirit. And then the Bible tells us we do something called praying in the Spirit between you and God. It doesn't require an interpretation. Paul said, "Pray that you might interpret." When you are praying between you and God, you are being edified as you pray in the Spirit. Some of the churches, they'll say, "Oh, you know, you have a private prayer language, praying in the Spirit." That's what they're talking about. Paul said, "Build up your most holy faith, praying in the Spirit." This is totally different than the gift of tongues in the church. The gift of tongues is when someone speaks loudly in tongues in the church for everybody to hear it. And then the Lord is saying that, you know, he's not the author of confusion, but of peace. So someone in the church should have the gift of interpretation and interpret that tongue for the church to be edified. That's what Paul says. "I'd rather speak five words in a known tongue that people can be edified than, you know, 1,000 words in an unknown tongue and then no one can understand." These are two different things. That's why the Bible says, "Forbid not the speaking of tongues." Lots of churches forbid the speaking of tongues. Lots of churches, just like when I did that revival the other day, brothers and sisters, when I went down there, lots of churches, Pentecostal churches, they have a praise and worship leader, especially in the Philippines. They get up there and they keep crying in the microphone and shouting in the microphone. They got the microphone turned up to the speakers are distorted, a distorted sound of the speakers. It makes your ears hurt because, like me, when I go there as a preacher, they put you on the front row and the speakers are right in your face and it's blaring and blasting. And no one could operate in the gifts of the Spirit if they wanted to. You know, it's always about that one-man show. And that's what's wrong with, you know, organized religion sometimes. That's why in the Bible, in the book of Acts, we see house churches. People met in people's houses in a group of, say, 20, 30 people. And that's why it says, you know, let people speak in tongues or have a prophecy, let them do these texts I'm quoting is 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 14. When you have someone speak in tongues or prophecy, let them do so one at a time. And then let it, you know, let someone interpret it. And then let the elders judge whether that prophecy or that tongues with interpretation is from the Lord or not, if it's biblical or not. Because see, brothers and sisters, someone gives a word of prophecy. Let's just use the example. The word of prophecy is like a dime, 10-cent piece, okay? Or a dollar, whatever you want to say. Let's count inflation. A prophecy is like a dollar, and then speaking in tongues is like 50 cents, not the rap singer, but the amount, 50 cents. And then interpretation is 50 cents. So if you take those two 50 cents and put it together, then you get $1. So that's what Paul is saying in there. He don't say 50 cents. But he says if someone speaks in tongues, unless there's an interpretation. So speaking in tongues, somebody has half. Someone interprets, they have the other half. So together is equal to one person setting up giving prophecy. Why does God do that? The biggest thing that's a stumbling block in the church and in the world is speaking in tongues. God did that on purpose. You know why? Jesus said, unless you become like a little child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. So when people have to surrender, absolute surrender, you know, there's a book written, you know, 80 or 100 years ago by this, I think it's by this guy named Murray. It's called Absolute Surrender. You know, and he's not talking about that topic, but he's talking about surrendering yourself totally to God. So surrendering everything, offering yourself as a living sacrifice, Paul says, Romans chapter 12, offer yourself as a living sacrifice. You know, the sacrifice of praise and worship. And that's why tongues is important for the individual, for your individual walk with the Lord. The purpose of tongues, let me take that back. Let me say this. You know, I got to be truthful. You know me, guys. I can't be, maybe that's why I don't have as many subscribers as those who are on here tickling people's ears. And as you guys know who watch me, I don't care. But many people, you know, it's sad that I'm even saying this. What people, you know, the information I'm about to give. Because people are so selfish and so focused on themselves. But I will say the personal benefit of speaking in tongues is that you are surrendering and trusting the Lord with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your physical body. You are trusting the Lord. It says that in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost, it said they spoke with tongues. They spoke with tongues. Not God didn't speak with tongues. They spoke with tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance. So as the Spirit of living, you know, the living water came out of their belly. When you speak in tongues, especially when you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, it is like a river of living water coming from your spirit, man, which is inside you, down where your belly is, like your diaphragm and your belly area, and then it just comes up like a rushing river of living water as you would speak in tongues. Now, when someone operates in the gift of tongues in the church, it's like that also. There's lots of times people are praying in the spirit and it's not so powerful because you're just talking low and it's just you and God. And then, the anointing can increase and then become a loud utterance for all to hear. And the spirit moves in different levels. Even people in denominational churches, the spirit moves some and you've experienced sometimes the spirit is stronger. Sometimes it's not so strong. Sometimes the spirit moves in a way for everyone to come to the altar for repentance. Sometimes the spirit moves in a way that, you know, that there's no preaching and then everybody will come, as I said, come to the altar and pray. Sometimes the spirit moves for church would have unity in all kinds of different ways that the spirit of God would move for what's needed amongst those people who are there. That's how God operates. Amen. And so, as I said, unfortunately, in this me generation, a lot of people contact me and stuff and they want to know about them. You know, how does this affect me? Instead of, what does Jesus want me to do? And that's why, you know, I'm not a people pleaser. You know, because it's all about Jesus. What does God want me to do? Offer myself as a living sacrifice. Now, what do I get out of it? Let God get the glory. That's why he wants you to speak in tongues, or he'll be glorified. I gave you your side of it, your benefit from it. You know, what's God's benefit? That he'd be glorified through his people. That's our sole purpose on this earth, is to bring glory to God. That's the purpose and the reason for the creation of man, to bring glory to God. What is God's purpose in us? To conform us to the image of Christ, to make us like Jesus, that he might be glorified in the Son and his people, us, his body, the church. So all of you guys out there, you know, and I've had dozens of people asking me, do I have to speak in tongues to go to heaven? Do I have to speak in tongues to be saved? And baptism of the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues is the same thing. The manifestation of baptism of the Holy Spirit is with evidence of speaking in tongues. So it's the same thing. They're synonymous. If you say in baptism in the Holy Spirit, theologically speaking, you're talking about initial evidence of speaking in tongues. It's baptism of the Holy Spirit. There's different feelings. You can be filled with the Holy Spirit every day. When you pray, you get filled with the Holy Spirit. It's not the same as the baptism of the Holy Spirit. That's an event, like what happened on Pentecost and all throughout the books of Acts. In Samaria, Acts chapter 8, Acts chapter 19 in Ephesus, when Paul had the blindness removed from his eyes, the end of Acts chapter 9, we see the same thing. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm going to give these words for people. I'm going to make a second video. So, I don't even know what I was going to say now, because I, it's in my mind about people, you know, about their own benefit. But it's sad. God wants us to bring glory to his name. That's why God saved us, so he might be glorified. Baptism of the Holy Spirit is a further event. That's what I'm trying to tell you. So when people ask me, you know, listen to me. There are people who want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, as I mentioned. I'm not talking to you. You know, God knows just what you want, and it's a matter of, you know, of having the word in your heart and faith and timing. God's timing and all these things is like people being healed. You know, sometimes God has a special time when he wants to do it that he might be glorified, you know, and speaking in tongues is the same way. You know, but the first thing you have to do is be in faith, and that's another video. I want to talk about that. You know, it says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. And he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 7, 8, right in there. Go check that out. Without faith, it's impossible to please God, and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7, and I think 8 is the second part of that. Maybe. Might be all verse 7. Anyway, go find it there. So, once you got yourself in faith, you're saved. You repented up. If there's any sin in your life, you repented of that. Then you're believing to receive. It's not God giving you the Holy Spirit. He gave salvation with his resurrection. He gave the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. He gave us healing by his stripes on the cross. He's already given it to the church. It's our job to receive salvation by faith, through grace, by grace, through faith. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, we receive healing by grace through faith. We receive answered prayer in all ways, baptism of the Holy Spirit included, by grace through faith. We receive those things of God. Brothers and sisters, it's not God has given it to us. He already gave it as provision for his church. We have to receive it. Once you get that in your mindset, then you can understand. But I'm not talking to you, brothers and sisters, and that's another video. Maybe some of you will receive the Holy Spirit from what I just said. There's been dozens of people who have been baptized in the Holy Spirit, you know, from my other videos that I made before. Praise God for that. And I'm going to do another one. But for those of you who say, I'm saved, you know, I already got enough, and, you know, I just want to make sure I got my ticket punched, that I'm good to go. If anybody is truly born again, they should want all of God they can get. They should get more everything of God they can get. It would be just like, you know, being at the foot of the mountain of Moses with the children of Israel, and Moses said, hey, God said all y'all can come up here on the mountain, and he's going to talk to all of y'all, which he did. But in that case, everyone was afraid to go up there because God's voice was like a trumpet with it. He started speaking the Ten Commandments, and his voice sounded like a bunch of trumpets and all that stuff. People were scared to death, and he told Moses, hey, you go up there. We're going to stay here. We're going to send you as our mediator. We want you to go talk to God, not us. But in Hebrews chapter 12 and in chapter 12 of Hebrews, it says, you know, we didn't come to that mountain where even Moses was fearful and trembling, but we've come to Mount Zion, to the church. And, you know, that other one is Mount Horeb, where he got the Ten Commandments. We didn't go there. We're not under the law. We came to Mount Zion, to the church of the firstborn, you know, to where God is and the holy angels and the saints that's gone on before us and all that. So we've come to the mount, not of fear, but of grace, where all things are possible to those who believe, brothers and sisters. And that's why I want to say and warn all of you who have not been baptized in the Holy Spirit. It's not about you ain't going into rapture. It's about the fact that why If you are a born-again Christian, do you not want to be as close to God as you can? Why do you not want all that God has for you? It's just like if I told you Jesus is up there on top of the mountain, it's the Garden of Eden, and the Lord Jesus Christ is up there. I just went up there and talked to him, and it's not. But let's just pretend it's written in the Bible. Okay, it's written in the Bible and says if you go to the top of the mountain, you can talk to Jesus and walk with him in the garden. And then I showed it to you. It's in the Bible, which it's not. It's a hypothetical parable here. And then I went there, and a lot of other people went there, and then you say, well, can I still go to heaven if I don't go up there and hang out with Jesus in the garden? Because I'm busy doing something else, and I don't feel comfortable. I don't feel comfortable going up there with Jesus, even though Jesus said in his word, Jesus said in Luke chapter 11, what son asks for a fish and you give him a stone? Or which son asks for, you know, a piece of bread and you give him stone? Or he asks for a fish and you give him a snake? You being evil know how to give your children good gifts. This is Luke chapter 11, not the other one in Matthew. You being evil know how to give your children good gifts. How much more to the Heavenly Father, who is perfect, give the Holy Ghost, our Holy Spirit, to those who ask? So Jesus is directly answering those who say, well, you know, I'm afraid I might get some other kind of spirit. Jesus says, if you ask God for the Holy Ghost, he's not going to give you a demon. Jesus himself said that, Luke chapter 11. You know, this is where you get into blaspheming the Holy Spirit. That's false teachings that people's been taught, and they don't know, you know, they're wrong. They are wrong. It's not biblical. Go read for yourself. Come and see. Come and taste, the Bible says. Come and taste that the Lord is good. Hallelujah. He's good. You know, there's another brother that made a video one time a while back, a couple years ago, and he was saying, you know, lots of times people who are unanointed, they'll go to, you know, around a preaching that's anointed, and they're riding on the anointing of somebody else instead of getting their own anointing. And that's really so true. You know, I have an aunt. I've only got one natural aunt, you know, by birth. You know, I've got some by marriage. I've got one aunt by birth. And my grandmother is a hardcore hard-shell Baptist. And she thinks speaking in tongues, all that's from the devil, even though she's told me many times she wanted to receive it, but God told her she didn't know how to use the tongue she had, so he wouldn't give her speaking in tongues. And that's probably true. She needs to repent up. That's definitely true. But anyway, my aunt, she went to a Pentecostal camp meeting when she was a teenager. And she had ringing in her ears since she was born, and she was healed. As a matter of fact, it was a woman preacher who prayed for her, and she was healed. You know, she fell out in the spirit and all that stuff. And because she got healed in that church in the name of Jesus, she goes to that church since she was a teenager. Now she's 55, 57 years old, and she goes there, never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Says she don't believe in it because her mommy doesn't believe in it, my grandma. But yet she's been going to that Pentecostal church for 40 years. Yeah, she was like 16, 17, whatever. She's been going to that church since she was in high school and doesn't believe in speaking in tongues, thinks it's from the devil, but goes to a church where they speak in tongues, and she was healed there. This is a classic hypocrisy of lots and lots of denominational people, even who watch my videos. I don't know what they do. Maybe they just compartmentalize their brain to that part because they think it's not from God, but yet, well, you know, it's, you know, we know the anointing of the Lord, but not our own, but from somebody else's. Our brothers and sisters, these things ought not be. You need to be filled with the Holy Ghost yourself. God doesn't have any grandchildren. There's no such thing as, what I call it, secondhand faith. God doesn't have grandchildren. He's got children. God's got the best plan made for you and me. He's got the best plan for you. And then you need all you can get. Some people say, well, maybe speaking in tongues is not for me. What? He gave it to the whole church. What did Peter say? Acts chapter 2. I believe it's in about verse 38. He said, this is for you and your children and your children's children, all that are fall off, as many as your Lord your God shall call. Now, if you're called to salvation, you're called to be a witness. You're called to be filled with the Holy Ghost. So that's why I say it's got to be motivated out of selfishness. Because Jesus said, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, you shall receive power from on high to be a witness for me. So maybe people don't want to be a witness for the Lord. They just want to make sure they're saved. And who cares about anybody else? Maybe that's what their motive is. Maybe they're afraid of God. But God, Jesus said, if you ask God for a loaf of bread, he's not going to give you a stone. If you ask for a fish, he's not going to give you a snake. If you ask for the Holy Ghost, he's going to give you the Holy Ghost. He ain't going to give you a demon. Luke chapter 11. And then in Hebrews, the Lord is God is telling us by the inspiration of his Holy Spirit. In Hebrews chapter 12, as I mentioned, we don't go to Mount Horeb where people were afraid and trembling at the presence of God. But we've come to Mount Zion, to the church of the firstborn. This is the New Testament. This is about grace and love and all those things, not thunder and lightning. For the body of Christ, it's not thunder and lightning, brothers and sisters. Judgment, as John the Baptist said in John chapter 3, he said, the spirit of, you know, the wrath of God remains on those who are not born again. If you're born again, the wrath of God does not abide on us. It's been removed. Jesus Christ is that big theological King James word. He's our propitiation. He's our atonement cover. He is the atonement cover over the ark, which we are inside, under the ark, in this metaphoric picture of the Ark of the Covenant. He is our atonement. He is covering and removing and blocking God's wrath off of us, the born-again Christians. Therefore, all we, by the grace of God, as Hebrews says, we have a better covenant. Hallelujah. Because the blood of Jesus, it also says in Hebrew, speaks better things than the blood of Abel. Hallelujah. Abel's blood spoke of death and what Cain killed Abel. But the blood of Christ speaks better things for us, those who are covered by the blood of Jesus. It speaks, God, this is part of my body. The Jesus says to the Father, Father, these are under me. They're covered by my blood. These are my people. This is my body. Thank you, Father, for giving me all you've given unto me. And I'll lose none but save that one, Judas Iscariot, as the Lord prayed at the Last Supper in John chapter 17. Praise God, we're covered by the blood of Jesus. We're the righteousness of Christ. We're not appointed unto wrath. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, but we're appointed unto obtain salvation through Christ. Hallelujah. Don't you want to give the good news to people? Hallelujah. You need power from on high to overcome all the fiery darts of the enemy. Part of your armor, you need power. Just like there's one brother, well, you really can't quote the scriptures. You know how I'm quoting these scriptures? By the power of the Holy Spirit, it's not in me. I don't have these Bible verses memorized. It's the Holy Ghost who's given me the power. So that people can't, the devil's people can't gainsay against what the Lord would have me say. Hallelujah. It's the power of God. Hallelujah. Manifest. It's not always some, you know, a miracle of somebody being healed. It's by proclaiming with boldness and conviction the word of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's not in here. Like I said, lots of people have that mental agreement that the word of God is true. For me, it's been washed down into my spirit by the Spirit of the living God. Just like I've told you guys in the past, when you are eating the word, it's like a bread. Can you imagine if you ate a whole bunch of bread and didn't drink any water? It's going to be stuck right in here. It's going to be all right here. You're just so smart and sharp with all these Bible verses in quoting doctrine you've learned. All that old doctrine from dead men, teaching dead men, the blind leading the blind with old dead doctrines. But when the Holy Ghost shall come upon you, it washes you. You're washed in the word. As the Bible says, the letter of the law brings death, but the spirit of the word brings life. So the Holy Ghost washes that word down into your spirit, brothers and sisters. And then it becomes that wellspring of living water that comes up out of you. John chapter 4, when you're born again and you're sealed with the Holy Ghost. And then to be baptized in the Holy Ghost is when it comes back out, brothers and sisters. Salvation is, I'm just thinking about it now from the Lord, when you're saved, you know, you have that wellspring of living water from John chapter 4, like the woman at the well. That living water is in you, and it's for you. You're saved. That's what, you know, that's the part that's for you. You're saved. You're prepared for entering heaven, but then God has something else. He didn't rapture you. You're still here. What's the purpose? What's the plan? To bring glory to his name by praise and worship, by proclaiming his word, by being a witness, by being salt and light. How do you do that? Jesus told us. He didn't say tell the disciples when he was getting ready to ascend into heaven, oh, go ahead and go out and go on to the uttermost parts of the world. He said, no, tarry in Jerusalem until you receive power from on high. If they didn't need the power, then he wouldn't have told them to wait for it. The promise of the Holy Ghost, we need it, brothers and sisters. Don't let any false doctrine, go read the Bible yourself. Don't let anybody tell you when you got saved, you received the power from on high. That is not what happened in the Bible, and that's not how it is. When you're saved, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit, and you're qualified for heaven when you're truly born again. And then, when you receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, it's so that you can operate on this earth. Salvation is preparing you as an individual for heaven. The Bible, you don't even need to read the Bible to get saved. You hear the gospel, can't even read and write. You're like a little child. You give your heart to Jesus. You repent of your sins. Call upon the name of the Lord. You're saved. You're sealed with the Holy Ghost. But you have to live life on this earth. That's why we have the Bible. Basic instructions before leaving earth, that you might be used by God in this life, that God's will might be performed in you. And the baptism of the Holy Spirit empowers you to do that. If you don't have the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you're doing it in your flesh. I know. I've been there. I was a pastor in a Baptist church. I know all about it. But you know, the thing about it was different to me and them. I read the Bible and I looked at what was happening. And I said, what you guys are doing is a tradition of men. I don't want to do the traditions of men. I don't want to be a Pharisee. I want to do things Jesus' way. I want to do things the way it happened in the book of Acts. I want to be like Jesus, not like you people. Bunch of hypocrites and liars and heartless, cold-hearted people. I don't want to be like that. I want to be filled with Christ. I want to be like Jesus. Praise God, God sent some Spirit-filled singers to the church. Praise God, and God sent them to me because and answered my prayer. And I was able to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit in a Baptist church. Praise God. And God used me mightily since that day. And by His grace, may He always, which I know He will, He said He'll never leave us nor forsake us. That He may sustain me, as He says in His word, all the way through to the end of the race. He who has begun a good work in you will see it through to the end. By His grace, our part is to continually humble ourselves. And brothers and sisters, you don't have to be perfect, because I am definitely not perfect. But I know that, and I'm always seeking God. I'm a truth seeker. And Jesus said to the Father in John chapter 17, Thy word is truth. I'm constantly seeking truth. I want the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth from God, from His Word, by His Spirit. The Bible is spiritually discerned. 90% of the nonsense you see on YouTube is just that nonsense. Get yourself rooted and grounded in the Word. Get yourself baptized in the Holy Ghost and do the will of God in your life. Run the race. The big question is not when's the rapture. You know why? Because when the rapture happens, it happens. Whenever the Lord comes, that's the end of it. The question for eternity will be, what did you do with what God gave you? What did you do? That's eternity. We're talking about forever. If you get a rewards, crowns, and all that stuff, you're going to have that for eternity. The rapture is just, it's soon, and that's going to be it. What are you going to do after the rapture happens? It's all over with. That's not eternal. That's not counting in eternity. That you knew when the rapture date was going to be. What counts as eternity is what you did with what God gave you, the talents that He gave you. Are you using them? I keep begging people. I don't care how many subscribers I got. I could care. It's up to God. It's up to the Lord, whatever He wants to do. Praise God. Stop. You know, why don't you get sold out to Jesus? Get sold out to God. Don't worry about pleasing people. Please Jesus. He's a one-man audience. That's what I told that church, what I've said on YouTube many times when I went to that church. I'm preaching for a one-man audience. That's the Son of Man, Jesus Christ. And I could care less if anybody else likes it or not. It doesn't move me. It doesn't move me if they ask me to come back again. It doesn't move me. Now, if they stone me, it won't move me because I got to run off. That's about it. I don't care. And you got to be like that for God to use you. Don't care what man thinks. I don't care about pleasing man. Doesn't matter to me. You got to be like that. Get to that place where you're immovable in Christ. That only Christ moves you. Brothers and sisters, I'm sure my neighbors think that I'm having a fight in here. I guess they heard me saying the word Jesus. You know, that's the good thing about the Philippines, you know. There's very few policemen, and it's pretty, there's no enforcement of any laws anyway. People won't call the police unless somebody's dead. Not like the States, with a bunch of tattletales. And in England, they've got the CCTV everywhere. In these European countries, and it's a nanny state. Thank God Almighty, the Philippines has lots of laws, but they don't enforce them. So praise God, there's lots of freedom here in the natural. Praise God for that, brothers and sisters. That's one thing I've noticed going back to the States, how much the police state has increased. Sign of the times, brothers and sisters. Playing for eternity now. We're playing for keeps. I'm going to be back. I'll make a video with the words for people. God bless you.